Just a quick update of what the party is going through at the moment. Tell us a quick overview of the support in the meetings. 36 days for elections. Give us an update.
Well, since the manifesto launch last month, our party nominees have been out in the field all over Fiji. They feel more comfortable now because we have the manifesto from which we can work. And to let people know, the principles that are there behind the manifesto, our dream for a better Fiji, and especially for our future generations. So at the moment, it is very good. We have been very busy. And we really believe that that we need to work towards a better future for our for the next generations, and the things that we have, the issues that we have addressed in the manifesto are to do with freedom, and we believe that that's a very important issue for our people, and also for reclaiming Fiji, for peace, progress, and stability and security. And we also want to promote and support racial balance and tolerance. That is something that, another thing that we believe in and we are working towards. And there are some other issues that are there in the manifesto that that we have spent some time in looking at what the climate is like in Fiji, and we believe that we can provide this for our people. So besides that, we also have in place other guidelines and other issues, and we are looking at the budget provisions for that in terms of education, for housing, for health. So those are the, I think, the important issues that I can just probably just speak on.
I've actually been through to most of your meetings in around Suva. I've seen there's a lot of support, a lot of crowd support. Are you looking at a landslide victory here?
I don't think any party can say that they are sure of a landslide victory or even think of that. Because when it comes to voting, people just, you know, people will vote for whoever they feel will deliver for them the things that they have been wanting. Perhaps they are not able to provide for themselves, but that they believe that the government will provide for them. So we hope that many people will be out there voting for us. And from what we're seeing on the ground, we are very hopeful that that we will have a good day at the polls, and that people who have supported us, we've seen from the elections of 2001 and 2006, that many of them are still with us today. And so at the moment, we can. I never like to predict a landslide on anything. Mm-hmm. So we just hope that the people are there with us, and especially the youth vote.
It's been spoken about that you are going to New Zealand. Would you be able to tell us what's happening and when is this beginning?
This trip to New Zealand is a very short one. It's only over a weekend. We have people in New Zealand who support us. And we have people in other countries where they, some of them have been forced to move out of Fiji to live, and they are supporting us there, and they have asked that we go and speak with them, and tell them what our manifesto is like, because at the end of the day, we hope that with their skills, many of them have lots of experience and expertise, we hope that one day they will think of coming back to Fiji.
From New Zealand, which country is next? Australia probably? Or?
No, we come straight back to, it's only over weekend when we come straight back
home. Tell us a little bit about what's happening in the States at the moment. I believe Mr. Ngarase is there campaigning.
Mr. Ngarase is there. We have many more people in the States, and he's there campaigning. I was there in July, mm-hmm. where we were able to establish a party branch there in Northern California. So our people there in the States are very, very supportive of what we are doing. And Mr. Garcia will be able to tell them a little bit more about what our manifesto is about. Because when I went there earlier, it wasn't out yet.
Mm. I'll keep to the topic of Mr. Ngarase speaking on behalf of the party. He's been making statements in Fiji. Do you support those statements?
The statements that are made that are according to the manifesto, we support. Mm-hmm. Because that is the party. That is the party policy and the party's stand. And I must say that we have some, it is not only Mr. Ngarase, we also have some nominees who go out and speak a little bit outside of the manifesto. Mm. And those we look at and we tell them that they have to stick to what is in the manifesto.
I'll quickly go through this. I was in Davuilevu last week. Mr. Ngarase told party supporters that he believed God had been taken from the Ethoke people. Do you also support this?
Pardon?
Mr. Ngarase told the people in Davuilevu housing that God has been taken away from Fiji and from the Ethoke people.
I will say that I do not support that that thinking. Mm-hmm. That is a thinking that that I do not share.
Now, you're a potential prime minister of this country. I've been following, I've been studying politics for a few months now. You've got tremendous support. That's why I asked for a landslide victory. You were in Lambasa with Nirmal Singh campaigning amongst the Indo-Fijian people. You could be their prime minister. You promised them that you will look after them. Do you think the work done by Ngarase now is rubbishing the work that you are doing?
I think with Mr. Ngarase and how he has been reported in the papers, it's just one person. It's one person speaking. He is a member of our. He's one of our very strong supporters, and he has worked very well for us and with us in the past. Just going back to what you had asked about the really good people that are there in the north, and many of them were young people who believe that there is a better future there for them, and they believe that we will deliver on that, on their dreams and aspirations. And, talking to them, I really believe that that is the way that we want to go. We want to work with different people, different communities that are here in Fiji, and we all call Fiji our home. Mm. They have contributed to the country as their ancestors have done. And they really believe that there's a better future there for them and that we are part of that future.
If you become the Prime Minister, you will be the Prime Minister for everyone, mm-hmm. all the race in Fiji, mm-hmm. Hindu, Muslims. Mr. Ngarase making statements on Muslims recently in Fiji. I feel that he's putting the party's name, it's becoming a shameful act for the party. Do you also agree with this?
This is what I'm hearing from the media. Mm-hmm. I was not there myself, so I cannot say that I was witness to that. Mm. You know, sometimes what the media portrays is something that is a bit different from what was actually what actually happened. Mm. So for me, I cannot say that. I cannot say that I support or condone it, mm-hmm. because I was not there. All I heard from the various meetings, mm-hmm. what was highlighted by the media.
So you were unaware of such statements being made by Ngarase?
No, because I wasn't there. Had I been there, I would be able to speak to that. Equal citizenry. I believe in equality, which we have had in our constitutions in the past, that we have equal status, and that's what I believe in. If we can work on that through the through our rules and regulations and our laws, which we have done in the past, and it has worked very well with us, we look at that, equality for all.
So you were supporting Garas's statement, saying that Fiji was given to the Fiji was given to Ethiopian people from God.
What I am supporting is equality for all, and equality for all is for those who are here presently now. You have to go into that particular issue that you're talking about. You have to go back to the indigenous who were the first settlers on this land, and we have the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples and the ILO Convention 169, in which the indigenous peoples, they are protected by the rules and conventions and regulations. And why is that? It is because they are the first people that arrived anywhere. They become the indigenous anywhere in the world. Whether it's in China or in India or in Fiji or the Eskimos in Iceland or in Greenland, they are the indigenous. And they have special privileges because they were the first people who arrived there. And because they were the first people that arrived there, they were the owners of the land and the owners of the Ngoli-Ngoli. So if you are talking about equality, you have to see that there are certain things that they owned before anybody else came to Fiji. So what we are saying is equality for all. In terms of how we are living now, we share the resources of the land, but we cannot say that everybody is equal to the first settlers on the land because they are the indigenous, and they are protected and provided for under the provisions of the UNDRIP and the ILO.
It makes sense now, ma'am.
So international conventions.
It now makes sense that you are supporting most of the statements by Mr. Ngarase, saying that not everyone can be equal.
Indigenous rights is different because everybody else has their own rights. But for the indigenous, you have to give special consideration for any indigenous people anywhere in the world. Because there are only 500,000. Yeah, there are only 500,000 of us. So if you don't help look after us, then we are lost. So we are asking everybody to help look after us as we are looking after them, and we are sharing this country with everyone because this all belongs to us. But when it comes to indigenous rights, that is different.
You have talked about a possible collision with Fiji Labour Party in recent times. How is the arrangement coming along?
They were very much a part of UFDF with other parties that had been in parliament in the past. And we have not drawn up any MOU or anything on paper, but we have an understanding that we will work together after parliament. Because we believe that they also have something to offer the people of Fiji, as they have done in the past, and we also have the same ideas of how we can work towards a better Fiji.
I interviewed Ms. Senyana Ranrunro from your party. She told me that invitation has been extended to other parties. Tell us about it. Have they responded?
At the moment, it's the Fiji Labour Party whom we have been speaking with. The other parties, they are also putting our feelers, let me say. So anything concrete? Not yet.
I spoke to Mr. Chaudhary last week. He's become a bit aggressive of what Mr. Ngarase is saying in PDA. He in fact told us there is no question of a partnership, and he will reconsider this partnership agreement after elections. Do you trust Chaudhary?
You know, in politics, you have to trust people. Because if you don't trust people, that means if we have people in our sheds and they say that they are Sodelpa voters, And if we look at them and we say, you know, I don't trust these people. Mm-hmm. With the SODEP party, as from SDL, we trust the people. Mm-hmm. So that what they tell us that they're going to do, we believe that they will do it.
Chaudhary said to us last week that he's not happy with the comments with Mr. Ngara say, and then he will reconsider the collision. He spoke on Fiji TV close up just on Sunday, saying that they will work together, or SODELP and FLP will work together. These flip-flop statements by Chaudhary, do you still adamant on working with such people?
You know, SODELP has made that commitment that we will work with the Fiji Labour Party. At the end of the elections, we don't know who is going to be voted in by the people and who will not. So that is our position right now, that we will work with the Fiji Labour Party.
So you still adamant that you will work with Chaudhary?
We are the people of our word. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the Fiji Labour Party that that we're going to be working with. The people that are in there, we will work with them as they will work with us.
Well, I'll jump back to the other questions. Tell our viewers on FBC TV right now watching you some of the key values your party is standing on. I believe some of them are putting God first in this country. Tell us about that a bit, becoming Fiji a Christian state.
All right. We have stated in our manifesto that we stand by the values and principles of Christianity. I think we have to go back. Sometimes we don't have the understanding of the history of our country. That in 1838, the Methodist missionaries arrived here in Fiji. And at that time, there was warfare, there was heathenism, there was cannibalism. That was in 1838. And when the Methodist missionaries came, through their work, they were able to transform the people. And the people that were here were the indigenous people, that were able to transform these people through the work of Christianity. That is why we are so strong on Christian principles and values, that through their work, they were able to transform these warfaring, heathen people. I mean, I'm talking like this, these were my ancestors, that they were able to transform us. So that through the times, from 1838 until now, we have most indigenous Fijians can claim that they are Christian. So that for us, we've seen that the Christian values and principles have worked very well for us in the past. And we stand by these same principles working for us in the future.
Would you be able to clear the air? There's lots of confusion in Fiji, and FBC does not want any confusion before going to elections. Mm-hmm. We represent the people. I'm the only one who is able to interview for them at this stage. Mm-hmm. Would you be able to clear the air? Does SODELPA want a Christian state or a secular state?
We are looking at working with Christian values and principles. We are not talking about a Christian state, that everybody has to be abiding by Christian principles. Because in the past governments have also worked with Christian values and principles. And if you are Hindu, you go and practice Hinduism. If you are a Muslim, you go and practice your religion. And any other religion that's here in Fiji, now or in the future, they have to work with the laws of the country. Mm. And that's the bottom line. You have to work with the laws of the country. So if you want to worship, whichever God you want to worship, you're very free to do that. And we, past governments, I'm talking about past governments because they cannot be here to speak for themselves, and past governments have been maligned. Mm. And I'm saying that past governments have been good. They have worked, you know, we all have weaknesses. We have the Prophet Muhammad's birthday. We have the Diwali feast day, and we have other other important dates on our calendar that have been removed. Mm. All right, so we abide by those principles that have been there in the past, mm. Christian, mm-hmm. And that we look at every religion that's here, as long as you follow the laws of the country.
I'll go back to the question again, ma'am. There can only be two forms of state in this country, a Christian state or a secular state. I'm still trying to understand, what kind of state will there be if you are the Prime Minister, if your government? Will there be a Christian state or a secular state?
You don't have to have a Christian state as such, eh? Because then you try to impose the Christian religion down everybody's throat. No, a young person who's Hindu, if he's practicing his faith, he's happy with that, why not allow him to do that? He's a law-abiding citizen, that's fine. But we are not going to shove any Christianity down people's throats. We allow them to follow whatever belief they have.
What exactly you are planning to do? I've read your manifesto. It says you will uphold Christian values and restore God. Would you be able to tell us what exactly that you are going to do?
Secular state is promoted by two people. And that's there in the 2013 Constitution. And if you were to go around now with a referendum asking the people, they do not want a secular state.
Mm-hmm. My question again, what exactly are you going to do when you say you're going to uphold Christian values?
Uphold Christian values is what we've been doing up until now, up until the 2013 Constitution. Schools teach whatever they want to teach. If they want to teach whatever religion they want to teach, they're very welcome to teach it. Christian schools teach whatever Christian denomination they belong to, as they have been doing in the past. The Hindu schools, the Sanatan schools, whatever they want to teach according to their religious principles, they continue teaching it. Mm-hmm. The Muslim schools, they continue teaching it. So it's no different from what has been happening in the past. So I don't know why people are making a big commotion, a big issue about the idea that we do not support a secular state. A secular state was before the missionaries arrived. If that's the kind of secular state people might want to look at, I don't know. But these Christian values and principles, the Hindu Christian, the Hindu principles and values that the Hindu followers have been following, that's worked for them in the past, and it will work for them in the future. So we just continue along those lines.
Mm-hmm. 20 years ago, when Fiji was some sort of a Christian state, there was no services on Sundays. It was a complete taboo. Are you looking at the same thing in Fiji?
You're talking about after the coup.
When Sundays were declared, there will be no shopping, there will be no shops open, no bus service. Is it similar?
I think you're trying to bring extremism into our conversation. And I would just like you to just stick by what we have in the manifesto. So, and I don't want people putting words in my mouth, so please don't go down that line.
Mr. Ngarase is now the face of SODELFA. You have not been coming out and doing speaking to the media and doing campaigns. Moving forward, since he's in the US now, will you be speaking to the media and going to campaigns?
You know, it's the media who have been highlighting all these issues on Mr. Ngarase. You people follow him around, and I wish you would follow me. None of you want to follow me. You know, I go to the rural areas where many of our people live, and we're happy that they're living there because they're making a very good life there. And we have to take our media team with us to ensure that we have any space, you know what I'm saying, that we have any space on radio or on TV or in the print media. Because you people don't want to go with us. We would be very, very happy for you to come with us.
A position was changed of Mr. Anasa Vodea being the party spokesman. What has happened? Would you be able to tell us?
In that regard, which was on the front page of the Fiji Sun, there were two witnesses right there with Ms. Randonro, who stated to us that what was there in the Fiji Sun was not what they heard. So if two people who were there have stated, I mean, they just happened to be standing right with her, have stated that that's not what Mr. Randondo said in the to the Fiji Sun, and what is happening in our party workings, the workings of the party, is something that we keep looking at and we keep refining. So so somebody can have a certain position here today, because they are all volunteers. Every one of the person, every person that you met here today, getting to this interview, they're all volunteers. So the positions that we have, that they have, is all it's all on a voluntary basis. So we might have somebody who's holding a certain position today, and tomorrow you go down to the office, because this is what you're going to be doing today. So that is what is happening in the party. We keep on refining. Some people go, you know, to Lombasa for some campaign work.
Yes. Now,
that happens.
Will you be taking this matter to the Media Industry Development Authority of what Fiji Sun has then, as you are claiming? Will you be taking this matter forward? Because it seems like this Mr. Ndondo has spoken out against Mr. Ngarase.
You know, we've had issues in the past with the media, and we have complained about it, but nothing has happened. So past experience has taught us that, you know, you might have a voice in the future, but right now we don't have a voice.
Will you be making a complaint this time? Because it's very less time for any media to put your party's name down at this stage, very crucial time. Will you be taking this matter forward? As you are saying, it was a misquote.
We could try that. But we also know that it's not going to go anywhere as it has done in the past. But with any issues that we have with party matters, we try to resolve it in-house. And that's how we worked.
Why should people vote for you, and what will you do for them if you are elected into government and become the next Prime Minister?
One of our major concerns right now is the state of the economy. Because whilst the parties are putting their manifesto together, we really do not know what the state of the economy is, so that we can actually budget for these issues that are there on the manifesto. So the state of the economy is one that we are very concerned about, and the state of the economy, we don't really have to ask, because people are telling us, you know, why are the poor getting poorer? Why is there so much unemployment? You know, my daughter or son has graduated from USP and is one of these thousands that are there in the NEC, in the National Employment Center, and they are not able to even get an interview with anybody. So, and the cost of living, 10 items that that used to cost that used to be at certain prices, for example, tuna, tin of tuna was 65 cents in 2006, is now $1.30 at least. And other items that we have costed, you know, almost double. So there's 100% rise in price. So people are telling us, you know, cost of living is, we just cannot handle it. Poverty is another one, where the poor are getting poorer. And unemployment, our children are going out there. So these are indicators when an economy is not as good as what people may be saying. So what we are asking the two gentlemen is what is happening to the Auditor General's report? Because from 2007, we haven't heard anything, although we are told, yes, it's out there somewhere, but where? We have not seen it. We have only heard of, you know, passing references to it, because we are very concerned about the level of borrowing and the terms and conditions of the borrowing. Where are they borrowing from? Because what we've heard is that our people, the generations to come, will have to be repaying these loans. We can't afford to be hanging something around their neck when they can't even get a job, let alone have to repay something that they did not have a hand in Because of so that that's one big concern that we have is the level of borrowing, the terms and the conditions, and what are the bonds that are out there. So that's a great concern to us.
What you said, that you are concerned with the economy and you are going to revive the economy. That's one of the promises all the political parties are making. How will you revive the economy? You haven't spoken of that now. Would you be able to tell us what will you do to revive the economy and generate employment in this country? I agree with you. There's about 12 to 13,000 people registered with the National Employment Center. What will you do for them to give them quick relief?
Okay, many of these people, they already have skills. You know, they've been able to live from one day to the next. They've been able to sell produce. So one big issue that we have in our manifesto is small micro enterprises, because they don't need to have any startup capital. They don't need to go to the city to try and find their customer base. What we are promoting straight away are the small and micro enterprises. Which means that we and one of the issues that we have in our manifesto is that we are going to do away with all the unnecessary licenses that have been imposed on the people, and they have to go and look for these licenses because if they go out fishing, they don't have a license, their boat and everything else is impounded. So that is a big issue that we are looking at right away, is the small and micro enterprises. And they can do this anywhere they live, whether they're in the urban, peri-urban, or out in the rural areas.
That's one of the things.
So that is one of the big ones that they can do right away. Take away the licenses, because this is a big millstone around their neck. And start off with what you can start off with around your area of residence. The other thing that we would like to look at too is the revival of the sugar industry. Yeah, that's a big one. It needs a major boost.
How will you revive the industry?
We will look again at what was taken away in 2007. It was the 350 million grant. This was the European Union, which would have improved on the mill and the infrastructure, the tram lines, the roads to the sugarcane growing areas. It would have improved the lives of the actual sugarcane farmers. So we would have to look at a major boost in that, and we can only do that by assistance from organizations like the European Union, which had been promised to us. It was almost there, but the coup took place. So the coup is responsible, really, for the 350 million European Union grant that was taken away just like that. So that's an area, and all the other sectors we are looking at in terms of exports. Mahogany, we had in place the downstreaming of the mahogany. So that's done here. We don't have to export all these huge logs that we see every day on the roads. They are partly to blame too for the deterioration of our roads, these very heavy logging trucks that are taking these resources away that can be done here in Fiji.
So production will be done.
Production. I mean, that's a major one. These are areas that, you know, we don't even have to look overseas, because we have the expertise here that can look at us. And we are looking at promoting business, you know, especially the small businesses. That's really what we want done.
Now, one question I must ask you, as you are a woman, what will you do for the woman of this country watching ABC TV right now? I think you are the only woman leader of a political party in Fiji, potential prime minister, watching ABC TV right now. What will you do for them specifically?
Just to go back to your last question, we're offering also from our manifesto a 200% rebate, a 200% tax rebate to all employers. if they will employ a certain number of employees, I think it's about 10 employees, so that 200% tax rebate is a big one. Mm-hmm. And this is especially for the school leavers. Because as we were talking about, you know, they're coming out of school, out of universities, going and registering themselves at National Employment Center, but nothing. So that's a tax rebate. For the women, we are trying to look at them as we are trying to look at their issues as mainstream issues, not necessarily for women. So that tax rebate, if it's a woman, 200% tax rebate for her. You know, Pure Fiji, eh?
Mm-hmm.
Pure Fiji is an international company, and it's a it's women who have started that business, and it's the women who are continuing that business and making it marketable internationally. So that's one business that's that women have started, and women have put it on the international scene. For women, we look at them as big time providers in our country. They are the ones who have these small businesses, but they are complaining to us about the licenses. Wailai, sa limngana leseni. Embadin total leseni ko koma na tin number and all this that we have to provide for. So they are the ones. If you look in any village or settlement, you will see the women very upfront there with their small business. And they are the ones, when the economy, you know, when the economy is not bright, in fact it's very dim, they are the ones that are carrying on with their small business, providing for their families, providing for the children who go to school, they go to the next generation, their grandchildren, great-grandchildren. So I take my hat off to the women. Women are the greatest people in this country.
Thank you very much.